For those of you who were not with us, we kind of started off with this scripture, Psalm 90, verse 12. It says, so teach us, this is a psalm of Moses. It says, so teach us to number our days or to measure our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. And he finishes it by saying twice, God, make our efforts successful. And how many of you know we need Jesus to make our efforts successful? Everything that we're doing is, it's really in vain if he doesn't make our efforts successful. And so we're talking about perspective, and we started off with eternal perspective. We're only here on the earth for a short amount of time, but what we do here on earth determines how we live in eternity. Or as Maximus said, what we do here echoes in eternity. I got golf references today. I got gladiator references. But how we live and how we manage what God has given us, the life that he's given us to live here on earth, really does determine how we spend eternity. And when we have that perspective, when we think of our end, which is really just our beginning, but when we think of that and we think of that eternal perspective, and from that place, we begin to shape our life, our goals, our habits. Everything that we do is based off of eternity, our eternal perspective. And the psalmist, David said in another psalm, the same thing of like, Lord, teach us just how short life is. Let us consider that. Moses is saying, let us measure. Let us measure this out. And why? Why do we measure it? So that we can have a heart of wisdom. And wisdom is different than knowledge. I actually saw this little quote on Facebook this week, and it said, knowledge is knowing that a tomato is a fruit, not a vegetable. But wisdom is knowing not to put a tomato in a fruit salad. And that really spoke to me. That's deep. It was. What kind of bonehead puts a tomato in a fruit salad? You just don't do that. But wisdom gives us the ability to make the right decisions. And in order to make a good decision, you have to be informed. And when we have this, and that's kind of what I was doing in the first session of just informing you, like, hey, now you can't go through life saying, no one ever told me, but somebody did tell you that eternity matters, and you have to live from that perspective. And what you do with your life here on earth matters, and God will judge us on that. And we will be held accountable for the life that we lead here on earth. And I know that's weighty, but God never calls us to do anything and not equip us to do that. And he sent the best teacher, the best guy we could ever have, the Holy Spirit. And he's there to help us and to guide us along the way and teach us the ways of God. In 1 Corinthians 7:17, it says, only let each person lead the life that the Lord has assigned him and which God has called him. So we know that we have to live with an eternal perspective. And we know that we're going to be held accountable for what God has given us. We looked at the story of the talents. But each one of us, our lives are a little bit different. And our purpose and our calling is a little bit different from the other person. And you're not going to be held accountable for what's the life that somebody else lived. You're going to be held accountable for the life that you lived and what you did with what God gave you. God give us a heart of wisdom. Wisdom teaches us priorities in our life. Wisdom teaches us what is the most important thing that we're supposed to be doing day by day. The Spirit of wisdom will speak to you, and it will guide you, and it will keep you on path. It will keep you in step with the Holy Ghost, and it will keep you aiming at the target so that we don't just wander around aimlessly, swinging at nothing. We are motivated by our eternal calling. Good news is that God is going to reward us. How many of you are excited for the day when we receive eternal rewards? I'm living for that day when we can stand before the Father and He says, good job, you good and faithful servant of mine. Enter in. Enter into my joy. And the great news is that we don't have to wait to get to heaven to begin to enter into that. We can actually begin to enter into the joy of the Master when we begin to do His business and co-labor with Him for His kingdom here on earth. As a church, that's what we long to see. God's kingdom manifested right here. Palestine, Texas. That's what we want to see. Your kingdom come, Your will be done right here in Palestine, Texas, as it is in heaven, God. That's what we pattern our lives after this. We're like, it's like, God, this is what we want. What must we do? What have You called me to do? What is my assignment? What is my calling? What is my destiny, Lord, here on the earth? Now, in the story of the talents, we see that God, being the Master, expects us to invest our lives. And investing our lives looks like taking the things that God has given us. Not the things that God did not give you, because you can't invest what you don't have. You can only invest what God has given you, right? And so if you say, well, James, I don't know what I'm supposed to invest. You've got to ask the Holy Spirit to open your eyes so that you can see everything that He's given you. And when He does that, He'll begin to show you, like we were singing earlier, Lord, it's Your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. What is it? We know that every gift, everything comes from God, even our breath. So God, You've given me breath. How can I take this breath and make it glorify You? How can I take this breath that You've given me and bring glory to Your name? I know it's so simple, but if we really grasp that, we wouldn't sit here and worship like this. All the earth. I mean, it would be like, God, You gave me this breath. I'm going to shout it out with everything inside of me. God, the breath that You gave me is not going to go wasted, God. It's going to glorify You in Your name. Amen. Your job, your career, your children, your family, whatever it is, everything that God has given you, He tells us to do business, which means invest that. It means to work it. You work what God has given you, so that it would glorify His kingdom. And that's when we begin to enter into the joy of the Master. As we begin to take what He's given us and we multiply it. We begin to multiply it here on the earth. God is after dominion here in the earth. He's already got it all. Jesus has already died. He's already paid for it all. And next week we get to celebrate that and how awesome it is. But how many of you know that God, His heart desires for everyone to know Him. His heart desires for every city to be changed. His heart desires for every church to experience revival. His heart desires for each one of us to come alive and walk in the fullness of what He's called us to. John 10:10, He's called us to walk more abundantly. He desires for you and for me to walk in this abundant life that we're called to. God wants you to succeed. Sorry, I'm getting excited. So last week we talked about you cannot invest what you don't own. I already touched on that. You can't invest what you consume. God did not create us to be consumers, but producers. We are creators here on the earth. We create things. Just like God put this earth in motion, this whole universe in motion, He created all of this. He actually expects us to be creators. Also, we're not just consumers. But in our culture, that's all we're told. every commercial, every everything. Buy this, consume this, consume this, consume this. Don't let it distract you from what you're called to do, what you're called to be. We're not just consumers. We're investors. We're producers. And then the last thing was that you've got to take some risk. Everybody say risk. And last time I said that, it thundered, so it was like God was really on my side. So we know this. We know what God's called us to do, but walking in it is not as easy. And I want to talk this morning about just one other investing term, and then we'll shut this series down and retire it. But I want to read this verse in Ephesians 5, verse 15. It says, "Look carefully, then, how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what is the will of God." I like this in the Message. It says, "So watch your step, use your head, make the most of every chance you get. These are desperate times." Make the most of everything, of every moment that you get. That's what we're after. Making our lives count. Now, I want to talk this morning about opportunity. Because like the talents, which represent what God has given to us, opportunity, each one of us has been given a different amount. And we know, just to reiterate, we will not be judged on, we will be judged and we will be held accountable for with the talents, the opportunities that God gave us. Don't get caught comparing yourself to what other people do and what they, or what they don't do. It's a trap. Stay away from that. But how do we know that an opportunity is from God? How do we know that this is, that God is giving us this opportunity? In investing, we have this thing called opportunity cost. And essentially what it is, it's a cost that refers to a benefit that a person could have received but gave up to take another course of action. To simplify that, when you make a decision, for instance, let's just say going out to eat right after this, and you say, "We're going to Pint and Barrel." Oh, they're closed on Sunday. So we're going to Taco Bell. And you made that decision. Yeah, somebody puked in their mouth over there. What was that? Okay. So you're going to Taco Bell, and the opportunity cost, what you gave up in order to make that decision to go to Taco Bell, was all the other restaurants you could have gone to. Does that make sense? You could have went to McDonald's. Somebody else puked in their mouth right there too. So, but we're living this life, and every day we have so many opportunities that are coming our way. So many, you know, chances and like, well, I could do this with my time. I could do this with my family. I could do, it's, and we're constantly, whether we realize it or not, we're making all these decisions off of the opportunities that are coming to us. And we're after this idea that Moses was saying, like, "Lord, teach us how to measure our days." Here in Ephesians, it's talking about how to make the best use. I mean, in order to measure something and make the best use of it, I mean, we've got to be able to see the results and what, you know, and these calculations and what is this, how's this going to affect that, the rate of return, all this stuff, and blah, 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 blah. And it's like, well, how do we know that the opportunities that we're saying yes to are the right opportunities? And right there in Ephesians chapter 5, he makes this distinction between the wise and the unwise. And the wise are the people who are making the most with their time. It is wisdom to take what you have, to measure it out and say, okay, this is what's going to be most effective. And then he says in verse 17, again, he says, don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. In order to know that we are investing correctly and we're taking the right opportunities, we must know what the will of the Lord is for our life. And I know I've been saying this for weeks, but I just want to reiterate it. Like, guys, don't go another day without finding out your purpose. And it is God's, it's His pleasure. He wants to show us. And I think sometimes we get caught up in this big thing. God, show me my purpose. You're going to shape the nations. Okay, I don't want to, if you get words like that, I don't want to, you know, say that that's not good, but okay. Well, like, how many of you have gotten a word like that? Don't point to the person that gave it to you, okay? Well, then, but then you leave, and you go, okay, like, how? And, you know, in Jeremiah it says that God has a plan for your life. And that word actually means purpose, too. That God has a purpose for your life. And there are many ways, many plans that will get you to that purpose, but there's some ways that are more efficient than others. And we don't just receive a word and then all of a sudden it's reality. These servants didn't receive the talents and then the master comes back the next day and he says, hey, look, you gave me five, here's five more. It takes time of investing and working. And some days you just have your head down. You're just working. And you have to stop for a moment and look up and say, okay, yeah, that's where we're going. I'm kind of off course a little bit. All right, let's get back to it. So, not only do we have this grand purpose that God wants to reveal to us, but He wants to reveal daily purpose to us. And the Holy Spirit wants to guide us and teach us how to get there. And He wants to equip us. And He wants you to take everything that you've accumulated over the years, whether it's in school, time that you've spent in His Word, time that you've spent communing with Him, every one of these things He's using when we're working it. And we have to resist the temptation to be selfish because we know that our purpose is tied with one another. Your purpose is not outside the body of Christ. And you can't do it alone, and you can't do it just saying, oh, I'm a rebel and I'll just blaze this trail. It just doesn't work. And God didn't create it that way. He created all these different parts of the body that are supposed to function together. So your purpose, you can find your purpose in the house of the Lord, in His people. And it takes humility to come to someone and say, hey, I don't know what my purpose is. Help me. And then God will use His body to show you where you're supposed to be, what your purpose is. And He'll reveal that. And you begin to work that. And I also realize that there are seasons. Thank God for seasons. And there are seasons of life where our purpose doesn't change, but how we operate in our assignment will change. It's like grandparents. Grandparents would be the worst parents ever. But, am I right? No. You guys let the kids do everything. I know. I'm saying the grandparents to the grandchildren. It's just, you want more candy? Here you go. I mean, it's like, but it's a different season of life. And you are still mothering and fathering grandchildren, but it's a totally different approach. And you just send them all back home jacked up and just high on candy and You discipline them. Yeah, thanks, guys. Seasons. Seasons change, but your purpose does not change. And the assignment that God has on your life does not either. I like to study successful people. One of the things in religion and outside of it that I find very common in highly successful and effective people is when you ask them, like, what do you do? Or in Christian world, we would say, what is your purpose? Like, what is your calling? What's your thing? Normally, if they've worked it for many years and they've refined it and it's been purified by God in a sentence, highly effective and successful people can tell you what it is that they do. And they do it so great. And I think that's kind of like the path that we're on. We're trying to find out what it is, God, that you've created me to do. And you just keep refining it. And you work it. And then you know what? Maybe it's the end of your life and you say, you know what? This is what I do. Bam. Because we don't want to get to heaven and God say, you know, hey, give account for being this evangelist. And you said, evangelist? I was working at Walmart. Or the other way around. Give account for what I gave you here in this school and these children in your house. And you say, whoa, I was an evangelist. We want to get it right. And God wants to reveal it. But we have so many opportunities coming our way. And we have to decipher which opportunity is the best one to take. And we have to count the cost of what it's going to take to build and what it's going to take to do this. And how much time and how do we measure that and how can I be most effective? And sometimes you just have to say no to other things. I found that the older you get, the better you get at that. But I want to look at this thing of opportunity. And here's some things that I notice about opportunity. That every good opportunity comes from the Father. James 1:17. Every good gift and every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Every good gift, every good opportunity comes from the Lord. And sometimes we choose the wrong ones. And how many of you are just thankful for grace and God who's rich in mercy and loving kindness? And even when we make the wrong choice and we come back to Him, He puts us right back on the path. But whenever you choose God's will, you can never look back and say, I made the wrong choice. Or I took the wrong opportunity. Choosing God's will for your life and choosing His purpose for your life always leads you down a path where you can look back and say, you know, at the time that didn't seem smart. That wasn't very logical to give up that job, to be at home more. That didn't really make sense for our finances, or it really didn't make sense for us to put our kids in public school at that time. But now that I look back, because that was God's will, and I don't care if you put your kids in public school or homeschool, that doesn't matter. Because it was God's will, there was no opportunity cost. You didn't lose anything. The second that this is that there are no opportunities in your past. They're not there. You're not going to find them. Don't waste your time looking back. All of your opportunities from the Lord are in your present and in your future. Do not get hung up looking for opportunities in your past. You'll never find them. It's nothing but regret. It's nothing but I should have, would have. Okay, you know what? God, help me. Okay? And what's so awesome about this word here, this phrase here in Ephesians chapter 5, you know, making the best use of time, it actually means to redeem the time. And that's what God does. What was lost? All those, when you look back, it's like God redeems that. So there's no opportunities back there. Stop looking back there. Somebody needs to hear that this morning. There's nothing there. Look forward. Notice the way our body is designed. Look at this. Our feet, they face forward. Our eyes are forward. Our nose is forward. Our hands, like this. Everything about your body. Did I look retarded right there or something? Everything about your body is designed to walk forward, to fight this way. Everything about your body is moving this way. There is nothing. This doesn't work. I just did that, and that was cool, but I could have fell over right there. There are no opportunities in your past. You can't change the past. We can only learn from it. Look for the opportunities that God has given to you right now, present day. Today, God, what are the opportunities you've given me? And honestly, look around here. These are the opportunities for today. These are the opportunities for Sunday. All these people that God has called us to come together and bless and to love on and to encourage and to prophesy over. We don't have to look far. Our opportunities are right here in front of us. And the other one is this, that we serve a God who moves heaven and earth to give us an opportunity. I just heard a testimony this at our men's group on Tuesday night. There was this young man who was there with us, and amazing testimony. And he was telling us his testimony, and he was strung out on meth really bad, and just in and out of jail, and just totally out of his mind, in really bad shape. And he's going into detail about this. And the night that his life changed, he's walking down the road. He's walking down the highway because he's totally messed up on meth. And he's out of his mind, and he's walking down the highway. Has no idea. And he had had enough. And he said, I fell down on my knees. And I had heard, somebody had told him that if you call out to Jesus, and he just said, Jesus, help me. That's all he said. And God saved him right there in that moment. And he told us, and this was like a couple years ago, that he hasn't even had the desire for meth since that. Amen. Since that moment with God. Amen. The God we serve, yes, is a God who moves heaven and earth, amen, to give you an opportunity. Amen. And if you don't believe me, look at what he did with his son. This collision between heaven and earth, and Jesus dying on a cross for all of us. Yet he didn't force us to choose him. He died just to give us an opportunity. Just to give you an opportunity. I think we get so caught up in thinking about miracles as, I don't see how I want to say this. Sometimes the miracle is the opportunity. And I look as I'm reading the gospel, and like sometimes I think, I think just the fact that Jesus showed up in some of these places, people were healed and they didn't even know it. Because just the opportunity to be around Jesus changed something. And he is the opportunity. And he's our reward. Sometimes the miracle is the opportunity. And we serve a God who moves heaven and earth to give us an opportunity. Isaiah 43, verse 16. I love this verse. It says, thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in mighty waters. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea. The God that we serve is a God who makes a way. Everything that he is calling you to has already been, the ground has already been leveled, and he has already made a way for you to actually walk in these things. He's made a way to give you the opportunity And what's the saying? The opportunity of a lifetime is only good for the lifetime of the opportunity. It requires us to have faith. Faith, guys, to walk through. Faith, and I want to say this, faith looks like working it. Faith is not jumping off a bridge and saying, God, catch me. Faith looks like you taking what God has given you and saying, God, I know this is what you've called me to. I can't see it. I'm nowhere near that. And right now, this looks like a bunch of turd that I'm doing. But right now, I believe you, God, and I'm going to work this, what you've given me. And I'm going to take one step after the next, God, and I'm going to walk, and I'm going to believe, and I'm going to keep my head down, and I'm going to work what you've given me. I'm going to work it. I'm going to invest it, God. I'm going to give every little thing that you've given me. I'm going to give it. And every once in a while, I'm going to look up, and I'm going to get my aim and my point, and I'm like, okay, that's my marker. Okay, I'm going to keep going. That's faith. The double doors. It's the year of the double doors. You got to step through the doors. God didn't give us double doors just to look at. And that word, just to go back, that Ricky released at the beginning of this year about the double doors, it is true. And that double door is alive in our midst right now. And there are some of you, and I'm so happy for you because you're doing it. You've already walked through the door. And I want to say, hey, come back here and drag some other people through it.
Amen.
Come on. I mean, God wants us to all cross the finish line, okay? Like, we're doing it as a team. We're doing it all together. It's like, you know what? If I'm getting God's favor, yeah, I'm getting it for me, but I'm coming back and I'm going to get somebody. Hey, let me show you how to walk through this door. Let me show you how to walk in your purpose. Let me show you. This is called discipleship. Jesus talked about it in the Bible. I didn't make that up. It's just showing people, this is how you walk in the will of God. This is how you walk in His favor. This is how you walk in His purpose.
Amen.
And I'll say this, it's not managing people's lives. Because remember, they're called to live a different life. You can only show them how you walked through your door. Why don't we stand this morning?